So I would like to thank the organizer, Professor Yun and Professor Wang, first for the invitation. It's very generous, and it's my fifth time in Korea. I still enjoy the food and my stay here. So I have to apologize first because tonight, actually my flight is 8 p.m., so I cannot join you for the banquet, but enjoy it. I definitely will be very nice, okay? So my talk for today is kernel-based collocation method for solving 3D Laplace equation, and Professor Michele already guessed how many pages I'm going to have. I'm not going to tell him, so it'll be hidden, okay? Uh-huh. Because he was in my talk last time for 120 something pages, right? Okay, so anyway, so you'll see how many I got. It's a continuation. Okay, so the outline of my talk today will be first, related to the title, is a kernel-based collocation. So now I use the short name called KBC, but actually, I make it up. So it's actually it's a collocation method using kernels. Okay, so something about the advantages and the disadvantages of this method, and then recently we use this for solving a three-dimensional Laplace equation, and then we have a conclusion. So it's very short, but. Okay, so kernels. So my collaborator yesterday already introduced this page on kernels. So it saved my time. So so basically what I did in my past 20 years is using kernels for solving various kinds of partial differential equations. Okay, so it becomes one of the most important tools in my life in research. So particularly for the so-called the idea of reproducing kernel hyperspace. So that's the kernel, and then I would say kernels everywhere, because now I can see it start with what we call kernels for interpolation, in the sense that we have a multivariate interpolation by radial basis function, and then in analysis we use all kinds of transform, approximation in statistics like spatial stochastic process, and then density estimation, learning theory, and in particular the machine learning, kernel machines. And then for my role here is using, as I said, a special kind of kernels for solving partial differential equations, involving the first is the radial basis function, and then extend to using fundamental solutions. So yesterday, my collaborator, Professor Dao, gave the talk on using fundamental solution for solving time fractional order partial differential equation and posed as an inverse problem. So that's the fundamental solution. Of course, it's not bound to just a fundamental solution or others. We can use a Green's function, particular solution for some others kind of problems. Okay, and then in this talk, it's talking about harmonic kernels. Okay. So I mentioned I start my my research using the radial basis function. So a basis function which is a radial basis function is the arguments in terms of the radius, and then the famous examples will be of course the thin plate spine, power spine, Hardy's multi quadric, and in fact yes.
Power spine, there's a J there.
Power spine. Oh yeah, okay, J. Yeah, sorry. Keep your mouth shut. Keep quiet. Sorry, we are good friends. So. Okay, and then actually, my first 5 years and multi-quadric become very, very important because it enjoys very special convergence, numerical method, very simple, and solving very kinds of partial differential equations. So this become so actually our method, I would say a so-called, we start with a multi-quadric method for solving partial differential equation. But then later we realized that multi-quadric is only one of the radial basis function. So then we use a radial basis function method for solving partial differential equation. And now I don't use this anymore because now the kernel becomes important, okay? And Chad is using kernels everywhere and so on. So now we use kernel, okay? The name kernels. Okay, anyway, then the idea is very simple. So I would say the so-called kernels for multivariate interpolation start with using radial basis function. So we are given scattered data, okay? And then a simple assumption asking me that the solution can be solved by assuming that the unknown solution can be represented by a linear combination of the radial basis function, okay? And then the interpolated condition immediately give a system of linear equations for the unknown coefficients lambda. Okay, so it's a very simple idea, and I would say a first year undergraduate immediately can catch the idea and know how to do the computation. Okay, and then I would say half of the citation of Professor Michelli as a highly cited researcher come from this very early paper. He didn't realize that at that time, because in 1986, because of this his paper on conditional positive definiteness of radial basis functions interpolant now got almost like higher than 300 something citation, right? 200 from mine, okay. Or from my group. Okay. Anyway, then the idea is very simple. So like in a surface interpolation, so instead of using so-called polynomial that may involve all kinds of so-called disturbance and so on, so we can easily, using the idea as stated, and then you can interpolate the surface of this so-called bivariate function, okay? And in fact, this becomes so well established, okay? So it becomes a software, okay? So now, if you pay and buy this so-called fast RBF software, and then you can perform all this so-called interpolation in multivariate. And then Professor Wu Zhongming got his first very early important local error estimate for radial basis interpolation, and Powell in UK, and Matic and Nelson, and Bison and Nielsen, and so on. So these are all the so-called, and Professor Yuan, or I'll be killed if I don't mention this. Okay, so Professor Yuan got his very important to us is a paper on the spectral approximation order of radial basis function for interpolation in the subgraph space. So these are all, I would say, well established. Okay, and also these are long fed. Okay, so in using this radial basis function, the Gaussian and the multi-quadratic are great choices because you enjoy spectral convergence. Okay, and then if the solution is very smooth, okay, then it will be very compared with polynomial or anything, it will be has a big advantage. Okay, but then there also has some problem. Say in the multi-quadratic as well as Gaussian, we have a so-called free parameter C, and this is very sensitive. Okay, and the convergence depends on this value. Okay, and then the interpolation matrix will become very ill conditioned, and we have a so-called uncertainty principle governing the behavior. Okay, so these are known. Okay, now then for the so-called kernel-based Caucasian method, basically I'm looking for solving partial differential equation as a boundary problem or initial boundary problem. Okay, and then for solving partial boundary problem, we in our I would say numerical method for undergraduate course, we start with most likely by finite difference method, and then in the last year, and then we are told that finite element will be much better. Okay, and then we have some so-called other method like integral equation approach, like boundary element that use integration by part to transform the domain integration into a boundary integration and so on. And then I mentioned about using the so-called method of fundamental solutions. And then because the fundamental solution contains singularity, okay, so we have tried some so-called boundary nooks method. So, and then get away the singularity. So these are some of these so-called the numerical techniques for solving binary problem in the society. Okay, and then the use of the so-called kernel-based Caucasian method for forcing binary problem can be illustrated in a very simple manner. Okay, so now suppose I want to solve a binary problem. So in the domain, it satisfies a past equation. Okay, and on the boundary, it has some boundary condition, like Neumann or Dirichlet or Robbins and so on. Okay. Now I treat it as these are all the so-called partial differential equation data. Okay. So it's like a scattered data interpolation. We have data, we have the points, we know the function value, and we want to find the unknown function that generates this value. Okay. So the problem now is how can, based on this so-called input data, I can determine a kernel, and this kernel will reproduce the unknown solution U. Okay, so that's I would say generalized interpolation problem. Okay, except that now I treat this now all information, the data. And this is called meshness computational method in our very early and still right now terminology. We call this meshless computation. And it becomes getting larger and larger with inference. Okay, so when we say meshless, we compare with, say, finite element. I don't know whether in your undergraduate numerical method, solving PDE, you have been told to generate this so-called triangular mesh for solving a problem. But usually no, because in undergraduate course, we will have a rectangle, okay? And then the element will be just a square divided by two, so it's a triangular. So basically, that won't pose too much difficulty. But imagine if you have an irregular domain, to generate this so-called triangular mesh can kill you already. Because, I mean, it has all kind of stability requirement on the shape of the triangles. Okay, and if you have one small triangle fail to fulfill this so-called shape requirement, it spoils the whole computation. Okay, so just generate this can kill you. And that is two-dimension. Imagine if you are going to three-dimension, so if your undergraduate professor in the numerical method for solving PDE by finite element asks you to do a final assignment of using general code for three-dimensional finite element code for solving this problem, then you are dead. Okay, 2 months, definitely you cannot generate the code. Okay, and then it's really difficult. But then if we use a so-called meshless method, you can imagine we just generate points. Okay, and that can be done in half an hour. Okay, so we call now this so-called pointization, okay, compared with a so-called mesh-dependent method. Okay, now then go back to my early work. So I start with using finite difference method in research to generate those so-called current flow and tidal height of this is the so-called the Pearl River. Okay, so if you haven't been to Hong Kong, you're welcome, because this is Hong Kong. And if you visit me in Hong Kong, your flight will land on Lantau Island here. Okay, and then this is our university. So this area is where the water will flow from China into this coastal area and so on. Okay, so finite difference method basically is to form the finite difference grid that cover the computational domain, and then for the derivative of the governing equation is using finite quotient formula, and then approximate the solution at grid point. So it's well established. The advantage is well established, easy to use. Disadvantage is, again, when you have an irregular domain. Okay, so you can see along this so-called irregular coastal line, then there's a so-called special treatment to handle this so-called finite difference grid. So finite element supposed to be handle this so-called irregular domain problem. But then still, as I said, because of the requirement of the depth of the water and also the shape of the boundary, generate this finite element grid for the coastal area, again, can be disaster. Okay, but the idea of finite element is domain discretization. So it's, the domain will be discretized into a set of triangular mesh. And then the assumption is the unknown solution is assumed to be a linear combination of a low-order piecewise polynomial. Okay, and then in each of these triangle grid, and then it's a low-order piecewise polynomial, so for solving partial differential equation, finite element needs a reformulation. Okay, so the differential equation has to be transformed to integral equation for getting the so-called the approximation. The advantage, of course, we all know, well established, and then in China or in the world, if you know the place, you can just download the software from the web, and then you can solve a lot of engineering problems using a so-called finite element software package. Okay, so but then the disadvantage is can be concrete as the meshing can be difficult and it's impossible for high dimensional problems. Okay, and then boundary element is an integral method. It can be as I mentioned, is a domain mesh become a boundary mesh, so it's a one-dimensional reduction. So I treat this is a kind of a finite element, but then reduce one dimension. Okay, now then the kernels, as I mentioned, is a meshless method. But this, even for the meshless method, we have two approaches. We can approach by weak formulation or collocation. So for big formulation, the idea is we discretize the domain by pawns, and for each of these pawns related to a smooth kernel. Okay, the approximation will then rely on how to approximate the unknown solution on by this so-called kernel as the so-called the trial space. Okay, so this require distributed nodal pawn moving this way approximation, and then the participle unity and so on. Okay, so the disadvantage is now it's really a meshless method. Okay, in fact, it has been defined what's called meshless method is if the approximation entirely depends on nodes, then we call this a so-called meshless method. Okay, now to me, the weak formulation should be more stable because of the integration that smooth out the so-called the boundary singularity or so on. Okay, but it still need numerical integration, and then you can imagine in the boundary can be again some technical problems. Okay, so I myself I don't like it very much, but if you are interested, these are the reference. Okay, so actually this come from the group of the finite element who wants to advance to get rid of the mesh. Okay, so we start with say element free Gong-Gong method or generalized finite element, and then we producing kernel particle method, and I would say more systematically now they call this a meshless local Petrov Gong-Gong method. Okay, and these are the reference, and as I say, I my contribution is very very neat to here because I just got one or two paper using the weak formulation for solving inverse problem. Okay, anyway, then the idea for kernel based collocation for solving boundary wave problem, as I say, is simple. So suppose I have a Poisson equation and then with a boundary data. So we assume that the solution can be approximated by using the kernels. Okay, so this kernel in particular is a radial basis function. Okay, and then this figure illustrates the idea. So in the interior of the domain, I use the discretization into pawns, and the pawns, the PDE data on the domain says that it satisfies the Poisson equation. So I got the so-called the collocation condition here. Okay, and then on the boundary, again, I have pawns. Okay, so on the boundary, I have the boundary condition. Okay, so again, this become interpolated condition, and then it turned up to be I have a system of linear equations that that will determine the unknown coefficient under K for the approximation. So again, it's a simple idea, and the matrix is we call this unsymmetric because we have the matrix come from the domain operator as well as the boundary condition, so it's unsymmetric. And this unsymmetric collocation scheme was first given by Edward Kanzer as a thesis in a conference in 1986, and now it becomes a so-called radial basis function, multi-quadratic interpolation, meshless computation, mesh-free, and so on. Okay, and my first actually contribution to this area was not using it, but disprove it, because it's the singularity of the matrix for some configuration that my collaborator and my Robert Sharpa that we developed at that time. So actually, this approach got a hole, mathematically speaking, because the matrix may not be invertible. Okay. Okay, anyway, then conclusion for the first part of my talk today concerning the kernel collocation will be compared with the finite element, the kernel-based collocation use smooth kernel, okay, so can enjoy spectral convergence. And then concerning the domain discretization is pawns only, okay, and contain the domain operator, finite element has to use weak formulation, but then we can use weak formulation as well as strong collocation. Okay. Now then the resultant matrix for finite element, of course, are usually they try to do it so that it becomes a sparse matrix and banded matrix for fast solver. Okay. For us, this is the major problem because our matrix is full matrix. Okay. So don't try to discretize the domain using 1 million pawns. Okay, and try to solve a 1 million cross 1 million full matrix. Okay, then you are completely nowhere to go. Okay, so that's a major problem. Okay, so concerning this, the known fact is, okay, I said that this in my previous talk. Okay, my whole life, basically in my last 20 years, was to prove one thing: is if finite difference method or finite element method or finite element method work, okay, then this should also work. So that's my major contribution. And it really does, okay? And that's why I enjoy so much, so many publications, because basically I just go to the journal, search for the problem done by finite difference or finite element. If they say, oh, it's very difficult because it's a boundary layer or moving and so on, I will do it, okay? And then basically in 1 week, I can get the paper done, okay? So that's the fact, okay? So I don't know, I mean, it's my experience, okay? But then the mathematical complexity leads to lack of theoretical proof, okay? So Professor Wu and I actually tried to do the very proof for this method, and we found that compared with finite element, they use a low order piecewise polynomial. So when you come to the error analysis, okay, when you talk about the Sobral space and the derivative, it's gone. I mean, the low order piecewise polynomial will die out, but we have smooth kernel. Okay, so when you differentiate, it's still there. And then more differentiations, more terms will be there. So that it makes the proof very difficult. Okay, and that's the drawback, I would say. And also the full matrix, as I said, lead to yield conditioning problems and stability and high computational cost. Okay, so these are the issues that we need to handle. And also I mentioned about the sensitivity of the free parameter. Okay, so this is already known, and we as in this field, we try to solve it. Okay, now then the advantage of this method, I would conclude very fast. Okay, so it's using kernel, smooth kernel, so we don't need reformulation. So very complicated model, we can do it easily. Okay, and it's points. So for you post problem like boundary layer, SOC, moving free boundary, and so on, it can be done easily. Okay, so I would say my first work using this radial basis function for solving partial differential equation come from one of my project with the Polytechnic University, the Rehabilitation Center. So at that time, they have this so-called triphasic mixture theory, try to design the socket to study the flow of the fluid inside the body so that to reduce the pressure and so on. Okay, so just not hurt it. And then it's complicated because it involves solid phase, water phase, ion phase, and then the governing equation still until today, I don't understand it because it involves all these so-called electrochemical potential and so on, and my chemistry dropped out in secondary school. So to me, this is, I don't know, okay? But to me, I just look at the equations. I mean, these are derivatives that I know, okay? So I treat it as just mathematical terms, okay? So the method, I mean, allowed me to set up a computational experiment and then test the domain and then with points and so on and enjoy quite a number of publications. Because at that time, the model was out, but no computation can be done because the model is so complicated, okay? And then thinking of triphasic, so the variation formulation was impossible at that time, okay? But then we did it, okay. And then for you post problem, my first trial is solving some kind of boundary layer problem, okay. So this is a very so-called benchmark problem to test the yield postness of the numerical method. So you have a perturbed parameter. So if you have a very small value here, then it becomes a very sharp boundary layer, okay. So the solution will start from zero and then jump to one and remain constant for the whole period. I mean, for the whole interval, 0 to 1, okay? But then within this, it jump up. So any numerical method will arrive at some kind of so-called unstable, okay? But then using this so-called adaptive log, it's more points close to the singularity, we can decide by this so-called threshold, and then this method can do a very good job within the epsilon interval, okay? And also remaining interval. So at that time, compared with finite element, with moving mesh and so on, I mean, this done much better, okay, for small epsilon. And in fact, I pushed to 10 to minus 8. So at that time, no numerical method can do it. But still, the method is so nice. And it's simple, okay? And the binary layer can also do with SAN 2-1 and so on. So this is one of my early paper using this method for this so-called binary layer problem. Okay, and this is the paper that made my name known to be the so-called the society, because this is using 7 points, and it's a nonlinear, second order, partial differential equation, burst equation with short wave, okay? And with only 7 points. So what I did is the middle point is always the peak, okay? And then always make sure 3 points on the left, 3 points on the right, okay? So when the solution moves with respect to time, okay, I will compute the next peak. And this can be done using Newton's method because the kernel I use is move. Okay, so I can get the peak, I will distribute the 3 points on the left, 3 points on the right, and then that's it. And then that is my second paper that make my name known to the society. So it's almost impossible because, I mean, compared to finite difference, moving finite element and so on, it compute much better, okay? And then recently, even a problem with singularity, like a problem from the financial world with a direct delta initial condition, and then so for that I use a so-called a basis function that will approximate the direct delta basis function, okay? And then it work, okay? So that's my introduction of the method, okay? But then for the so-called conclusion here is that it's really meshless, easy to use, better, okay, but then concluded into three so-called disadvantages: full matrix, yield condition, and then for large scale problem is impossible, okay, for this so-called full matrix and lack of theoretical justification. So the solution to this one is, I mean, about 8 years ago we developed a so-called greedy algorithm to solve this large problem, because actually we do not start with the full points, okay, we start by building the points. So we got this adaptive greedy algorithm. Okay, so if you don't have a matrix, there will be no yield condition. Okay, so that's one approach. And then for the large scale problem, then starting from about 3 or 4 or 5 years, we already modified the method so that we become a localized kernel method. And we have already implemented this one and compared with all benchmark problems of the finite element solver, and much, much better. Okay, so this will be our so-called, in our group, is our future hope that can really do a large-scale problem. Now for the mathematical proof, then this is today's talk, is for this particular three-dimensional Laplace equation, then we try to use harmonic kernel, okay, for theoretical certificate, I would say this one, okay. So this is so I have only 15 minutes for 3D Laplace equation. So how many pages left? Can you guess? Okay, so the idea. Okay, so I would say for this so-called harmonic 3D Laplace equation, so it's very tempting to use harmonic kernels. Okay, because based on the maximum principle, the error bound on the boundary immediately will be implied to the domain inside. Okay, so that's the main idea. And then Professor Wu at that time in Hong Kong, actually we were the first. Okay, using this so-called harmonic kernel to solve an inverse boundary determination problem using this harmonic kernel. But we didn't proceed because at that time, for the inverse problem, we do not have the idea of a technique of regularization technique and so on. So we got some problem when we have a noise on the boundary. Okay, but now we have this knowledge. So now I know there's a group in Chengdu already pick up all this harmonic kernel, and we do most of the inverse problem, and quite impressive. Okay, but anyway, the talk I'm going to introduce is I want to use so-called harmonic kernels for this three-dimensional Laplace equation. Okay, so I would hopefully I have time to conclude this one. Is for this one I would arrive as a so-called Poisson kernels and the Bessel kernels. Okay, and then this is the Poisson kernel, so you can see that's the Bessel kernel, so the J seal function, and they are symmetric and harmonic in both arguments, and mathematical is important, they are positive definite, okay, and then for the numerical consideration, they are scalable by a parameter C, okay, so that's what I want to achieve, okay, so to do that, I would start with a so-called well-known fact again. So a good approximation to the boundary data by interpolation, okay? So now, I mean, suppose I use kernel, approximate the unknown function on the boundary, the function on the boundary, okay? That this can be done by solving the so-called system linear equation involving the kernel, okay? So this is already in terms of multivariate interpolation or solving partial differential equation that we know, okay? And then the domains for illustrating these kernels basically will be a uniball, a spherical one, and actually it's more in general in a so-called star-shaped domain. Okay, so in terms of radial split coordinate, and then that will be the radius will be limited by the function that describes the boundary curve. Okay, and then with the argument of the angle theta and phi. Okay, so that's the shape of the domain. Okay, now then let's start with spherical harmonics. That's well known because suppose YLM is a real value spherical harmonics that are already normalized to be orthonormal on the sphere S squared. Okay, so I start with this so-called spherical harmonics. Okay, and then the function f can be have a L2 expansion on the sphere. So in terms of all these so-called YLM spherical harmonic function. Okay, so then we got this representation. Okay, so using this one, okay, then we have the support space, okay, and then with all the tau, it is the span of all these functions with the corresponding norm. Okay, so this is the starting tool I want to use to build up this so-called harmonic function for the 3D Laplace equation. Okay, now then from this Legendre polynomial on the sphere, okay, so we can define a so-called Sonnold kernel on the sphere, okay, and so then now I got the kernels on this so-called Sonnold kernel on the sphere. So again, this can be done, okay, but this is not harmonic in the domain yet, okay. So I need the reproducing kernel space. So now the unique Hilbert space that can reproduce all these so-called function. Okay, so now I got this so-called parameter tau that appear here. So now the Hilbert space can be represented by this in terms of this the Legendre polynomial. Okay, with the corresponding norm and the inner product. Okay, so from the spherical harmonic, now I start building this so-called Sonnold kernel. Okay, now then using the some kind of normalization technique. So this so-called spherical harmonic kernel can be normalized, and then finally, what we did is that now we can have a harmonic extension of the function into the unit ball. So from the sphere, now we have the harmonic extension. Okay, so now you can see basically we add one more the R to the power L to the original spherical harmonic. Okay, so now we have this so-called harmonic extension. Okay, and then the theorem one will be, suppose now we have this representation, it's a function g in terms of the spherical coordinate, can be represented by all these spherical harmonic. Okay, it's well defined and absolute convergent on the sphere. Okay, so that we have an error, okay, on this sphere in the maximum norm somehow. Okay, and then for this function which is continuous on the sphere, assume now the solution u will be the solution of the three-dimensional Laplace equation. Okay, and then with the boundary data given in terms of the f. Okay, now then with this one, the function v, okay, which use this the representation of this harmonic. Okay, so extended into the unit ball is harmonic into the unit ball, and then because of the Bessemann principle, you enjoy the same error, okay, estimate. So that is basically the idea: spherical harmonic, harmonic extension into the unit ball, and then finally we come down to this one, okay. But then the drawback, okay, the drawback is the theorem only restrict to the sphere. What happens if your 3D the plus equation is defined on a long, it's not a good shape unit ball, okay? So, so it's not easy to generalize to a more cold smooth manifold in the R3. The second drawback is now you can see that the representation of the harmonic functions, will be in terms of infinite series, okay? And then interpolation formula, you need to sum up, and numerically speaking, we have to ask how many terms we should sum. We cannot sum to infinity, so it becomes some kind of numerical consideration. Okay, so to achieve this one, so we again extend the Sonnold kernel. Okay, so to the unit ball in terms of this Legendre polynomial. Okay, and then now we have this so-called harmonic kernel. Okay, and then we add the scaling constant into this so-called harmonic kernel. So now we have the form of the harmonic kernel. Okay, and then in terms of this Legendre polynomial. Okay, now the good thing is, for a particular case, Okay, we have the sum of these PNT and the SN will be in terms of analytical function and so on. Okay, so we have this so-called analytical formula for this infinite series. We make use of it and we arrive at the two harmonic kernels that I mentioned from the very beginning. Okay, so now we got the Poisson kernel and also the Bessel kernel using this built-in formula. Okay, then of course, I mean, it's not restricted to just these two. Okay, you can imagine that if you have other formula concerning the sum of the infinite series, you got some more. Okay, but we just present these two. Okay, now this is the shape of the Bessel kernel. So with the sonal angle different, I mean, you can imagine that this is the Bessel kernel. And then for the Poisson kernel, so this is something like this one. Okay. Anyway, okay, so concerning the singularity, okay, I mentioned from the very beginning, okay, so our harmonic kernel should not contain singularity, otherwise I better use fundamental solution. Because fundamental solution has proven to be very effective, okay, except that because it has singularity in the function, so we need to add a so-called Fisher's boundary to locate the source point as illustrated by yesterday by Professor Dow in her talk. Okay, so we want to avoid the singularity. Now, concerning the Bessel, of course, is free. Okay, no singularity. But for the Poisson kernel, okay, then if you turn this into two terms, so this can be zero, providing that x and y are proportional. Okay, and along the x as x equal y. Okay, so in other words, the Poisson kernel actually has an isolated singularity at the so-called Miller point, and the Miller point depends on the scalable parameter C and the position of the X. Okay, now then the good thing is, of course, for practical problem, we can avoid this singularity by tuning the scaling parameter C so that the singularity will be outside the domain. Okay, so that can be avoided. Okay, now figure to illustrate, suppose now we consider this so-called special region domain, okay, and then for the given domain, you may have this one, but if you change the C to 1.2, okay, and then you have a so-called Miller domain, and then now you can see the singularity somewhere along here disappear, okay, so it's outside the domain already. So this is the trick, numerically speaking. But then, at the conclusion, I'll mention that. Okay. Anyway, then our theorem 2 says that for the harmonic kernel of the Bessel or the Poisson, they are positive definite because this is what we need to have the immutability. Okay. So for this kernel, in this general form, okay. So a simple illustration can prove that this is non-negative. So this is positive definite. Okay. So that's our I would say concerning this particular harmonic kernels, okay. So we have this so-called mathematical proof on the immutability, okay. And then a theorem by Lagrovich and Ward in 2002 mentioned that there will be a constant C depending on this tau in the kernels, okay, and the operator that for the set X of scatter point on the sphere in interpolation on the sphere. Then for all function g in the Hilbert space, okay, the interpolant, okay, satisfy this so-called error analysis, okay. So h is like the density of the point, okay. So and then tau is the scaling parameter, and then the function norm, and so on, okay. So again, this is a 3D Laplace equation, and then we can enjoy the maximum principle. So from this, we immediately got our theorem 4, saying that I mean now this so-called the error analysis on the sphere can be extended to the domain. Okay, so that's basically the approach of this using this harmonic kernel for solving the 3D Laplace equation. Okay. Okay, so some numerical examples. So as I start very early, we use a spherical one, most smooth, and then we form a so-called UFO domain. Okay, so because it's like an unidentified fine object in the air, so this is a so-called UFO domain. Okay, so to test the numerical convergence and so on, we just use the adaptive grid algorithm. So we just add points, according to where it will be the minimum residue and so on. So this is, we start with this so-called numerical computation, and then the result, I would say, for harmonic functions, okay? Then for the sprinkle domain with the Bessel kernel or sprinkle domain with the Poisson kernel, the convergence is very impressive, okay? It's the order, or the average order is like up to 13 to 12, okay? It's special convergence. For the unidentified fine optic domain, okay, for the Bessel and the Poisson, okay, they are also very impressive. Okay, so that's for harmonic function in the domain. Okay, but then for the long harmonic, okay, then immediately you will see that, I mean, for this one, it still keep good, but then very bad for this one. And then for the K5, means this is how we, from the harmonic kernel, we sum up to the term 16, and then we assume this is the long harmonic one, and then put it into here. So still being good for sprinkle one, but then for the UFO, so not smooth boundary, okay? So the convergence much worse in some sense, okay? Actually, I mean, if you look at this one, this is something like H to the power 2.5, okay? And we are not satisfied. We are not like a final element guy who's satisfied with our convergence of 2, okay? 2.5, we feel bad already. So we are looking at convergence of 10 or 11 or 12 and so on. Anyway, then, this is a kind of convergence order that we experienced already. Okay, so 2 more minutes. So conclusion, and so I would say the convergence order in this presented example seems to be exponential. Okay, and does not depend on the shape of the domain if we have a harmonic solution. That's a good thing. Okay, and that's true because we use very smooth harmonic kernel and approximating very smooth harmonic solution, then of course we are expecting special convergence. Okay? For long harmonic cases, the domain become critical. Okay? And in this sense, the Poisson kernel, because it's like inferior because of the singularity. Okay? So in this sense, we should avoid singularity kernel. But my point of view, as like I present in one of the examples, if we have a Dirac delta singularity in this initial condition, we should use basis function that contain singularity, because this is what reflect the nature of the solution. Okay, so I would say, I mean, if we are looking problem with solution that may have singularity, okay, the singularity in the Poisson kernel might be good. That's why the fundamental solution done perfectly in solving inverse problem, because the inverse problem is U-pose, and the singularity in the fundamental solution fit the U-poseness. Okay, so that's my immature conclusion at this moment. But anyway, that's the conclusion, and thank you for your attention. I just make it. How many pages? 66.
Very good.
Okay. Okay, thank you.